So, you know when most speakers say, I'm really happy to be speaking to you today? Well, I really mean that, right? How many of you have spasmodic dysphonia? Okay. And you all know that I have it or had it as well, right? I'm going to tell you a little bit about my story, then I'm going to tell you a little bit about success in general. That's what my sort of canned presentation is about, but we'll get to that in a minute. I'm going to tell you my story in sort of a fast-forward way, but when you hear parts that are familiar with your own story, I want you to audibly say, oh yeah, oh yeah. So one day I had a normal respiratory problem. I thought it was no big deal. I had a little laryngitis, but it lasted a long time. Went to the doctor. Doctor said, it's probably just some normal thing. So he tried treating some normal things. That didn't work. He tried, he said, check out the ENT, see if there's anything down in your throat. He found nothing. Sound familiar? And then my trail kind of grew cold after a while, right? I tried all the things that my doctor recommended. I went to the ENT, he said, I don't see anything. I don't know what the problem is. And then when I went back to my doctor and said, what else you got? He said, maybe you should talk to the psychologist. Sound familiar? And so I did, and so she listened to my story and I explained how I can speak fine to my cat, but I can't speak to human beings. I can speak fine before a person walks in the room, but when they walk in the room, I go, and she said, maybe we should give you some drugs. And maybe fix that brain of yours, which is clearly broken in some way. You must have some sort of anxiety problem. And I thought to myself, the only problem I have is this, right? I don't think I have a general anxiety problem. But I decided to not do that, right? Instead, I ended up looking for the source of this problem myself. So I set my, let me back up a little bit. Years before I had a voice problem, I had a hand problem. When I would overuse my hand, it would spasm, and that too was a mysterious problem. And when I found the doctor who could finally tell me what that was, by coincidence, one of the world experts lived in my town in Pleasanton and worked at my Kaiser facility. So he said, yeah, that's a focal dystonia, a muscle spasm. Now, I'm going to skip from that story. You just have to know that it happened, right? I had a problem with my hand. In time, I found a way to deal with that, and now I draw on a computer, which takes the problem completely away. But time goes by, and now I have this mysterious voice problem. And one day, after not being able to find the solution anywhere, I just had one of these moments. You know, you're sitting there and you think, I wonder if there's any connection between this hand problem and the voice problem. So I went on Google, and I Googled voice dystonia. And boop, up pops up a spasmodic dysphonia. And there's a little clip on there on YouTube, and you know where this is going, right? I played the clip, I'm like, that's it. All right, there's no question, right? When you hear it, it's like, that's it. So now I had a name for it. Now I could take it to my doctor, and now my doctor said, oh, I think I can find somebody in the system who knows that. I did Botox for a while. For me, it didn't work. I think it worked sort of once when I was getting, luckily when I was getting married, it did work, so I could say the I do's. But in general, it didn't work. I think I've got a weird vocal cord situation going on there. I was also using the method, the dead reckoning, trying to get the tone to work by shoving needles into your neck. So there was a little imprecision involved in my technique. So I decided I had a tough choice here. I could either keep doing the Botox, which in my case didn't work, and I would just always be like that, you know, in this kind of poor, broken voice that worked every other week half the time. Or I could quit Botox, go back to the worst case scenario, and then I'd have a baseline, so if I tried other things, I would at least know, is it working, and it wouldn't be masked by whatever was happening with the Botox. So I tried every little thing that popped up on the internet. I set a Google alert until anything would pop up. And, you know, all these little folk remedies don't work. You've all tried them all. You've tried probably the cough syrup and all the other crazy things that make no difference. Eventually, something popped up about a surgery. I tracked that down, long story short. Dr. Damrose led me to Dr. Burke. Dr. Burke said, come on down. I said, blah, 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 blah. And he said, you have spasmodic dysphonia. I think you looked in my throat, but you know, you didn't really have to at that point, right? So I did the surgery. You all know of the surgery by now, right? You've been here. Is there anybody who's not up to date on the surgery? You know everything about it. You know that it's not guaranteed. And at the time, I thought, well, if it doesn't work, there's a chance that nothing after that will ever work, right? Because once you start mucking around, who knows what happens after that? But I decided my life, frankly, wasn't worth living the way it was. And I decided that a chance of losing my voice entirely was really not much of a risk at all compared to the alternatives. So I took the surgery. And where's Dr. Burke? Yeah. Remind me, was it 8 weeks you wait from the time of the surgery until the nerves regrow?
Usually
3 months, okay. So whatever it was that you told me, I remember marking it on the calendar, and every day I would try to talk, and it's this weird feeling where your brain is not connected to your vocal cords, so you're thinking words and your mouth is moving and nothing's happening. It's kind of strange. But 3 months of choking on my food and a pretty unpleasant time as things were coming back to normal, and just about whatever that period was, 3 months, just about to the day, as I recall, my wife at the time walked in, and I said hi, and it worked. Now, it was a long time, really probably almost a year before I could have a strong voice, and it's gotten stronger every year since then, by the way. I don't know if you have that experience, but my voice today is the strongest it's been since the surgery. An interesting thing happened. I'm kind of, you have to know my personality a little bit. When I reach a concrete wall, if I need to get on the other side of the wall, I just start chewing, right? I don't care how long it takes, right? If I need to get on the other side of the wall, I'm gonna chew through that thing. And before I found the solution, the surgical solution, I had promised myself that if I could get my voice back to normal, that I wouldn't be happy with where it was, because I had a terrible voice. And I decided that it would be a stronger voice and a better voice than it ever was. Now, you may not be able to tell it from here because I don't have a great voice, but this is better than any voice I've ever had in my life, all right? This is better than I ever had before the spasmodic dysphonia. And part of the reason is because in the process of trying to chase down a solution, I did a lot of voice therapy with a number of different people. They all had their take on it. If you can't tell, I'm trying to speak roughly in the key of F. I don't have good musical skills, so I don't know how close I am, but I can tell you this is not my normal tone, all right? My normal speaking tone I don't use anymore because it's hard and it damages my voice over time. It's probably contributed to the problem. So my normal voice, if I can even reproduce it, would be deeper, would be more like this. But if I spoke like this, you can already tell it starts to break down a little bit, so it's a little rougher. If I spoke like this for a long time, it would be really rough on my equipment, right? So instead, I've learned over time to speak at a higher tone, and this solved one of the biggest problems I've ever had with voice, which is I go into a busy place, let's say it's a party or a bar, you're trying to say something over crowd noise. If you match crowd noise, compared to nobody hears anything. But if you learn to speak in the higher pitch, it's not only better for your voice equipment, but you can pierce right through the lower tones of the background. So, bottom line is, spasmodic dysphonia, nobody wants it. But I gotta tell you, I came out ahead. I'm way ahead at this point, all right? And this is gonna launch us into what I wanna talk about. I'm gonna talk about success in any context. It doesn't have to be money, it could be just whatever you want in life. Throughout your life, you've probably heard these little things about success, right? There's a set number of things that everybody says. I, as you might imagine, have a contrarian view about success. But I have to tell you before I get into it that if you've ever taken advice from a cartoonist on anything important such as health or finances, it probably didn't work out for you. So nothing that you hear today is advice. It's not intended as advice. Because advice doesn't really work once you get outside of the medical field and maybe the legal field. And the reason is, well, think about this for a moment. Imagine if I gave you all the advice that I've accumulated over my life about how to become a cartoonist. Would it work for you? Probably not, right? Because you're not me, the situation is different. The fact that I became a cartoonist makes it hard for anybody else to do a Dilbert or at least a workplace related cartoon because it's compared to me. So everything that happens changes the situation. So there's no advice that is sort of general and works for everybody. If there were that kind of advice that worked for everybody, there would only be one book of advice, right? They might update it once in a while when there's some advice about your smartphone or something, but basically you'd have one book of advice and it would cover everything. But that doesn't work. It turns out every situation is different. But what does work when advice does not is it helps to have more tools, all right? So isn't it nice to know that you've got an option, maybe Botox works for you, maybe surgery, maybe something else works for you, all right? Two tools is always gonna be better than one. So I'm gonna give you a way to look at this topic of success that's very different from what you've been exposed to before. I don't say that this is gonna be better for you in all cases or even any cases, but you can have two tools now. One is the traditional way to look at it, and one is the way I'm gonna walk you through. So here's what you're gonna hear today. Goals are for losers. Passion, totally overrated. And luck can be manipulated, not directly, but I'll talk about that later. But first you need some context. You heard a little bit about it in the introduction. When I was putting this together, I thought to myself, you know, I should tell people how many things I've failed at so they get a sense when I'm talking about success, what's my context. When I started writing down my business failures, I got to 36 before I quit. And I only quit because I was crying at that point. You know, it was awful. And this is just my business failures. You know, forget about my personal life. That's like a whole other presentation. We don't have time for that. But I'm not going to dwell on them, but just give you a sense of them. So I failed in software pursuits. I've tried inventing things that didn't work. I had two restaurants that didn't work, a food company that didn't work. I've bought real estate three separate times at a high price and sold for a low price. And I live in California. That was hard to do. A lot of people couldn't have done that, but I did that. And on and on. So many different failures. I'm going to tell you about just one of them, just so you can get a sense of these. First one, my first big failure was in college. I was a sophomore, and when I came home for the summer, I had this great idea for a product. And I thought, this must be patentable for sure. And my product was this. It was a rosin bag, the type that a bowler would use to keep his hand dry, combined with Velcro to put that bag on your tennis shorts to keep your tennis hand dry between points. And then you could remove it when you wanted to wash the shorts. And I thought this was a genius idea. Every tennis player would want this. This would sweep the country. I got a meeting with my lawyer, the only lawyer in our town, and I described my idea of the rosin bag and the Velcro and the pants. And he sat there in silence for a while, and he said, just because you can attach two existing products together with Velcro, that doesn't mean you invented a thing. And so I was crushed and humiliated in this effort, but in the process, I learned out a whole bunch about how to get a patent, which came in handy later. And that's a pattern which you'll see throughout this. So although these 36 things didn't work, some things did work, and Dilbert was one of them. Wearable computing is the next big thing. This is my prototype of a neckless computer. Prepare to be shocked. Did you just talk him into wearing a remotely controlled shock collar? People think I have no goals. Speaking of goals, I say goals are for losers, but I mean that not 100% of the time. If you have a simple situation, a goal is fine. Let's say you enter a contest. Your goal is to win the contest. It's simple, it's near term, it's even artificially constrained to be a simple situation. It's a contest, right? But the world isn't always like that. It used to be. If you went back 100 years ago, the farmer's operation was pretty easy. If that farmer had a goal, let's say his goal was to clear 40 acres before winter, That was probably a pretty good idea. And when winter came, and if he had done that, he would probably say to himself, that was a good idea, I'm glad I did that, and everything would work out. Simple times, goals were great. But that's not how it is today. Today, you have more complexity in your pocket than the farmer had in his entire operation, right? Your phone, think of the decisions just about your phone. You know, do I need the insurance plan? What data plan? The family plan? What technology? What software? Which hardware? All of that, all right? In that situation, everything's changing all the time. So having a goal in a world like that is a little like being on horseback at a full gallop. You've got a bow and arrow, and you're shooting at a goal that's in the forest behind some trees in the fog, and the target's moving back and forth on its own, and you brought one arrow, all right? That's what a goal looks like, all right? Now, if enough people on enough horses shoot enough arrows into enough forests with enough targets, one of those people is going to hit a target. And you know what happens when that person hits a target? He writes a book, and he says, it's a good thing I had a goal. Right? The people who missed, they don't get to write a book. All right? So you get this misleading sense that goals must be pretty good, because those successful people, they all had them. All right. The other problem with a goal in a complex world is that the point of a goal is to focus. You put your blinders on, you say, this is my goal, this is the only thing I care about. When you're doing that, you necessarily don't see other things. That's the whole point, right? Now, it could be that there are better things that are not your goal. What are the chances that that very specific thing you wanted today, 5 years from now, turned out to be, oh, I nailed it. I really knew what the world would look like in 5 years. You don't. You really don't. You don't know what's going to happen with you. You don't know what's going to happen with the world, the industry, technology, anything else. All right. So if goals are limiting, and by the way, when I said goals are for losers, one of the problems is psychological. All right. If you have a goal and you haven't reached it, you're in this perpetual state of, I'm not as good as my goal. I like to get there. I hope I'll get there. I'm an optimist, but I'm a failure right now. All right, compare that to a system, which I'm going to describe in a minute. This is my own definition. In a system, it's something you do on a regular basis that improves your odds in a general way, not toward a specific goal, but toward things that are all kind of good things you would like. But here's the important part. No matter what happens along the way, and there will be lots of failures along the way, you've got to pick those failures such that when they fail, because most of the times, 9 out of 10 things don't work out the way you want, that even in failure, you come out ahead, all right? That's what defines the system, is that you can fail and still win, all right? Let me give you some examples, because this is kind of unclear until I run through a few examples. I had a friend in high school named Manuel. Manuel and I both liked girls. We both wanted to have a girlfriend, but we had two different approaches. I had what I would call a goals approach at the time, and the way that worked is I would identify the girl who was the one I wanted, you know, the cute girl in the class, and I would find out as much as I could about her. I'd talk to her friends. I'd learn what habits she had, what hobbies she had. I'd try to show up where she might be. Months would go by, and eventually, after I'd, you know, worked this plan and done all the research and the legwork and the preparation, those things are good, right? Preparation is always good. I'd eventually approach the girl, and one of two things would usually happen. One, she would say, I have a boyfriend. Okay, you know, you don't win them all. Two, sometimes she would say, I don't like you. But sometimes, and this didn't happen a lot, but sometimes she would say, I have a boyfriend and I don't like you. I'm proud to say I did not contribute to the teen pregnancy rates whatsoever. Manuel, however, did not have a goal or approach. He had a system. His system was this. He would go where there were lots of girls. He would approach every one of them in ascending order of attractiveness. And he would say, would you like to be my girlfriend? Now, as you can imagine, his hit rate was not very good. All right, he did not succeed very often. But this is not a story about, oh, try until you succeed, right? That's, you know, the old story. Get back in the horse if at first you don't succeed. That's not my story. My story is that every time he failed, he got smarter, all right? He was building a skill. He was finding out how to approach strangers. He was figuring out if I say this, they react this way. If I say this, they react the other way. He was doing A-B testing. He was getting a thicker skin. He left this with skill and a girlfriend. All right? I didn't have skill or a girlfriend. Right? Let me give you a few more examples. A friend of mine had a system. He would apply for jobs and go on interviews for jobs that he did not want. He had a really good job, but he worked at home, he was a tech guy, and he didn't get to meet a lot of people or network, so his career was a little bit bound by how many people he could meet. So he would use the job interviews as networking. He would just go to the interview, meet some people, they would be impressed because he was always overqualified, there were jobs he didn't want. And he learned how to be a really good interviewer. One day, after a few years of this, and he would always tell me what his system was, he went on an interview and the interviewer said, you know, you're way overqualified, like every other time, but our CTO just quit. You'd be perfect for that job. And so he got this gigantic raise in promotion by operating his system, which simply increased his odds that something good was gonna happen. All he did was he let the universe know he was there. He made himself available, he met people, he left the house, and he met the right kind of people, and he did it often enough that luck was more likely to find him. Let me give you some more examples. Here's what I use. You know, if you're like Tiger Woods, you probably know it at six, like if you have some special skill that's, you know, world class, but most of us don't have that. But you can get to that by layering fairly ordinary skills. So for example, if you were to layer public speaking on top of whatever else it is that you're doing, you would be the first person that your boss would think of when the boss needs a replacement, right? Because whoever can speak in front of the crowd is a little more management material or leadership material than someone who can't. Now, I took the Dale Carnegie course that everybody in the class who took it could do what I'm doing as easily and enjoy it, right? So what they do is they teach you how to enjoy it. So when I'm up here, some of you are probably thinking, I wouldn't want to do that because I don't like this public speaking. Everyone in the class thought that. At the end of the class, everyone wanted to do this. They would volunteer to do this, right? Just like I do. So it's easy to learn. Other things that you can learn, I can't learn second languages, I don't have the skill, but you probably could. Psychology, there are about 50 concepts in psychology that if you don't understand, at least on the two sentence level, somebody's probably using those things against you, all right? So I would recommend a book called Persuasion. It's kind of the best book in the field for that, to get a flavor of how much stuff you're missing, all right? And then just start paying attention because the internet can serve up all of these stories of studies and psychological phenomenon. Terribly important. I use it all the time in my work. All right, and you should have a little bit of a business sense and a technology sense to do anything these days, so those are good skills to layer on top of whatever you've got. Dilbert was the first comic strip to be on the internet every day. It sounds funny because it was so long ago that was actually it was a big thing to put a comic on the internet one day, because it was thought that, you know, they would all be stolen and copied and the business model would fall apart. That only happened because I knew about technology. I worked in a lab at the phone company, so I knew enough to know that this would be a good idea, right? That simple layer of knowledge on top of what I was already doing was worth millions, right? Basic design, I think that you could learn the basics of design in about an hour. You could get about 80% of it, and you would need it for everything from designing slides to designing, you know, whatever your presentations are, to your website, to your everything. Everything is design these days, right? Anything digital needs design. So if you put these basic skills together, you might add up to something. Now, it doesn't have to be those ones I mentioned. Those just happen to be ones that layer on top of anything well. But let me give you an example of some normal talents layered together. In my case, I'm a mediocre artist. Nobody would ever look at a Dilbert cartoon and say, wow, that guy's Norman Rockwell. He can draw. Look at that. In this room, a room of this size, there are probably 3 to maybe 10 better artists, all right? I'll never win a writing award. In fact, I've never taken a class in writing except a one-day, two-day class, I think, in business writing. In this room, probably again, maybe more. There might be 10 people who can write better, people who have better grammar, people who, you know, just can spell better, all those things. I'm not even the funniest person in the room in my own house sometimes. If I have a party, you know, 3 people are funnier than I am, but I'm funny enough, right? My business skills are kind of average. I'm not Warren Buffett, but it's good that I went to business school because it made a big difference in trying to commercialize my comic business. Now, you put those average talents together, and Dilbert is in 2,000 newspapers, and it's a, you know, worldwide brand sort of thing. So that's the system. I'm going to talk about diet and fitness. There are doctors in the room, so I want you to give me no credibility whatsoever about anything I say. And I mean that, because none of this is meant to be advice. I'm going to tell you what I do, but it's only in the context of describing a system versus a goal, all right? So I don't want you to do these things, just understand it as a system. So if you were going to take a goals approach to losing weight, here's what you would typically do. You'd say, oh, I'm going to use my willpower here. I'm just going to resist the cookie. I'm going to put the spoon down. I'm going to push away from the table. Arr, willpower. And we know from every study and every observation and every personal experience you've had, that rarely works. Some people can do it, but most people can't, all right? So compare that to a system. Here's what a system in which you could replace willpower with knowledge. Now, when I say that, your first reaction is, wait a minute, you can't replace one with the other because those are just different things. But let me give you some examples. Let's say you and I go to the salad bar. I hate saying this in front of doctors because I know this is going to go badly. But let's say you go to the salad bar. And it's a terrible salad bar, and all they have is a plain white potato and some regular plain pasta. You're trying to watch your waistline. Those are your only 2 choices. Raise your hand if you pick the potato. A few potato eaters. Raise your hand if you pick the pasta. A few more. A lot of uncertainty. Turns out the potato was the right answer, and it's a fairly significant answer because the glycemic index of the potato is bad, and the glycemic index of pasta is surprisingly not so bad. It has something to do with the way it's processed, science imagines. That's the best guess they have. But they're very different, all right? So you go to the salad bar, you pick the potato, I pick the pasta. You go home, you get fat, I don't. You say, man, that cartoonist has a high metabolism, right? But I don't. Or you say, he's got good willpower, but I don't. Raise your hands if you know that eating peanuts is correlated with losing weight, or at least maintaining weight. Right? Few people have heard that, right? Those of you who didn't know that, what do you do when you're hungry? I eat peanuts. What do? Right? So I have, through knowledge, a way to solve a problem. I get hungry, I go, here's some peanuts. And it kills my appetite, because the whole point of it is that the good fats, like the peanuts and the avocados, they kill your appetite better than simple carbs. Raise your hands if you knew that being tired feels to your body exactly like being hungry sometimes. Did you know that? All right. So now imagine that, those are just a few examples I threw out. Now imagine that there are 50 of them. But you can learn 50 things in a few hours, right? So you could pay attention and you can move yourself up the curve pretty bit. Now let's imagine that we want to eat healthy, but it's your day one. You said, okay, day one, I'm going to be a healthy eating person, but I don't know how to do that. On day one, all the stuff you used to eat is delicious, right? It's up here. And this stuff you want to eat is terrible. It's down here. All right, that's day one. Here's the system, and this is the one I use. Every day, practically, I experiment with ways to flavor things that are healthy, right? So I know, just from my own taste palate, that if I add soy sauce to a yam that I've simply heated up in my convection oven, it's really, really tasty to me, all right? So now I can eat that, and it's just as good as whatever this was. Well, maybe not just as good, you know. You can't beat a French fry, but you can get pretty close. So when I need to use willpower, I still need some, but I only need this much. Because the difference between that delicious thing that I'm trying to resist and the thing I've now learned how to flavor, not so much. Right? So Let's take the same concept to exercise, all right? If you had a goal-oriented approach to exercise, you'd say, willpower, no pain, no gain, right? I'm gonna push it and push it. It's the breaking the muscle that's the good part, right? You know, you gotta push yourself. I don't do anything like that, all right? I try to replace willpower with a habit. And here's what I mean by that. It turns out that if you were to rank all the things that you need to do to be healthy in terms of exercise, books and books would be filled with it, right? It's like, when do you eat your protein and what kind, you know? How much do you hydrate and when? Should you do the lots of reps with small weights? What if you're a woman? Is it different? Should you take the vitamins? All right, on and on. It'd be just books and books written about the right way to exercise. But as luck would have it, it turns out that there's one thing that just flies above all those things. And if you get that just one thing right, the other stuff works itself out over time. You don't even have to worry about it too much. And that one thing is, are you active every day? Right? Do you do it every day? Do you do something every day that's active? Because if you do, it forms a habit, all right? And the way you form habits usually is you reward yourself. So what I do is I try to underdo it when I exercise, all right? The amount of exercise I do every day, and I do pretty much every day, is an amount that's gonna make me feel good that day, right? Which means not hurting myself. Because if I do something that makes me feel good, like a long walk, or maybe I go to the gym, I lift some weights, whatever I do, I say, that was a pleasant experience. And then I give myself a nice protein shake and a cup of coffee and a few minutes of downtime. I'm pretty busy, so a few minutes of downtime is a real treat for me. And I actually train myself with a treat that by this point, this literally happens. By about 11 a.m. every day, my body just starts vibrating. And I can't even stay in my seat because I have to go exercise because it's just such an ingrained habit at this point. Now, through these systems that I've used, which, by the way, I don't recommend because a big part of the process is finding out what works for you, right? I've got a friend who just runs marathons when he wants to lose weight. Who is he, right? What kind of human is that? Right? Everything I do is it doesn't really apply to him. He could just use his willpower because it works for him. For the rest of us, not so much. All right. Here's a little trick I learned from my hypnosis teacher. When I was in my 20s, I took a course on hypnosis to learn to be a hypnotist. I thought it would help me with dating. It's another presentation. But he told me this trick. And if you don't believe anything, you find no credibility in anything I've said today, just try this one thing. Because if it works, it'll make you think the other stuff was smarter too, right? So there'll be those days when you want to do something. You want to be active, you want to exercise, but you just don't have it. You're just wiped out. Hard day at work, whatever. You know you need to, it's just not going to happen. Here's the hypnotist trick. Don't say you're going to go exercise. Just put on the clothes to exercise. And give yourself permission to just wear them around the house and take them off and go to bed with them, whatever. Don't commit to exercising, because mentally, you're just not there, right? But commit to putting the clothes on. That's easy. Those sneakers, they feel pretty good. Hey, I feel pretty good, right? You walk around the house a little bit. And what happens is the association of the clothing will just trigger the subroutine in your mind that says, feeling a little better than I thought. Next thing you know, you go off. Right? I can tell you that about four times a year, I have those times when I'll put the clothes on, and then I'll go to the gym, and I'll it takes me about 20 minutes to go there. I drive there, park, walk across the long parking lot, and I'll get into the middle of the gym, and I'll look around, and I'll say, nope. If I had a goal, I would be failing, but I do not. I have a system which is about doing this every day until it's such a habit, I can't even not do it, all right? So I go to the gym every day. Now, how do I learn all that other mountains of other stuff? When you're doing something every day, it sets your filters, all right? If you decided tomorrow, I'm gonna be playing lacrosse every day, you start noticing articles about lacrosse, you're just drawn to the information. The information is gonna start getting through your filters as soon as you're doing it every day, right? So that's the only thing, make it a habit. Again, not a recommendation, just what I do. So what this looks like is if you fix your diet and your exercise, you get that right, that'll give you enough energies because you're gonna fail at a lot of stuff. You're gonna need a lot of personal, physical energy to fail at a lot of stuff and still be okay with it and want to do more stuff. But you want to make sure that you're increasing your personal value at the same time, right? Let's talk about passion. If you ask a billionaire what is the secret to success, what will they say more often than they ought to? These guys, for example, will often say passion. You got to follow your passion. You need passion, all right? But I ask you this. How else could they have answered that question in public? Suppose they thought the real answer was that they're smarter than poor people. Can't say it. I'm not saying they think that. I'm just saying if they did think it, they couldn't say it. Suppose they think they work harder than poor people. Well, probably their gardener would have a different opinion about that. Maybe the person who cleans their mansion would have a different opinion about that. They don't work harder than other people, right? They can't say they're lucky. They say that sometimes, but they can't totally say it was luck because then nobody wants to work with them. It's like, well, you can't reproduce it. Why do I want to work with you? All right? But there is one thing you can say that everybody thinks is sort of democratic. It's like, you can say passion because it makes it sound like something that everybody can get. It's like, yeah, I'm a billionaire, but I got passion. Oh, you have that too. Yeah, just use your passion and you can get $1 billion. It's kind of easy, actually. Passion it up. I had a boss when I became a commercial lender, one of my first jobs, and of college. He had been a lender for many years, and he said to me, one of the ways that you know you don't want to make a loan to someone is if they say they have passion for it. He goes, if somebody comes in and says, I love sports, I want to open a sporting goods store, you don't make a loan to that guy because he's in it for passion. When things go wrong, as they do, because it's business, he's gonna bail out. He's not in it for the right reason. Compare that to this guy. He comes in with a spreadsheet. And he says, I've looked at this area and it's underserved with dry cleaning places. I've got a franchise guy, I've got money, I'm gonna put my skin in it. I've done three businesses of this nature. I know to operate a business, I know how to hire and fire people. How about a loan? That guy gets a loan. How much passion did he have for his you know, dry cleaning? Probably none, but he was a good business person and he probably was real excited if it worked. Like he'd probably pretty interested if it worked. So as I was talking about this to a friend of mine, he said, you know, I hear what you're saying, I get your argument, but I can't believe that the people who win American Idol, for example, passion wasn't important to that. Clearly, to go through all that heartache and, you know, and all the pressure and everything that they do, the practice, you'd have to be passionate to put up with all that. I said to him, do you watch the show from the beginning of the season? Because when I watch it, I see stadiums full of passionate people, and every one of them is a loser, right? So if you were to go by the numbers, I would say the passion is far more correlated with a stadium full of losers than the one person who won. I'm just going by the numbers. Look around this the hotel. You've got carpets and chandeliers and equipment and stuff. Some company made all that stuff. There's somebody who is either the founder of it or maybe it's the CEO now who is rich and is probably pretty excited about his job. They might love their lives, but they're not excited. They're not passionate about light bulbs and ceiling tiles and carpet. The world is full of things that were simply good ideas that made people happy and they were useful and it contributed to the world and passion wasn't so much a part of it. And let me just say that you know, I've done lots of things that worked and some that didn't, or more that didn't work. I was about equally interested in all of them, right? Cartooning, and I have to tell you a little side story. When I was talking about this to a reporter, he said, you know, I know Warren Buffett. I want to see what he says about your thoughts on passion. So he sent my notes to Warren Buffett, and Warren Buffett wrote an email back to me, you know, through a third party. He said, I'm paraphrasing here, but essentially he said, oh, Scott, I don't even think you believe what you're saying, that you must think that passion was necessary to your job. Look at the NBA players, for example. He goes, there's no way you make it to the NBA unless you're passionate about that, because all the work and the practice and stuff. And I read that, and I couldn't respond because it was through a third party, but I thought to myself, you know who else was passionate about being an NBA player? Me. Right? I really wanted that job when I was a kid. Right? Just like every 10-year-old boy who can pick up a ball. We're all passionate about basketball. I wasn't 7 feet tall. I couldn't jump. It didn't matter how passionate I was. It really was irrelevant. So here's what I've discovered over time, just my observation. I am pretty excited about Dilbert, but I gotta tell you, I'm pretty sure I would be excited about anything that made me this frickin' rich. So it's been my experience, the passion is something that can catch up to you, if you know what I mean. So you can go first, just let it find you. All right, so instead of passion, I recommend, and this part I will recommend, even with doctors in the audience, work on your health, all right? If you get your health right, everything else works out after that, right? If you get your fitness right, every study shows that you have a better chance of getting the job, getting the spouse that you want, the lover that you want. Everything comes from your physicality first. So fix that part, and you're gonna have a good base, all right? So let's talk about, I'm double mugging because I heard that passion is necessary for success. By 4 p.m., I'll be so passionate, I'll be dating my chair. Nothing about that sounded right. All right, let's talk about luck. I say luck can be manipulated. You should be skeptical about that. But luck is always the elephant in the room when you're talking about success, right? You have to be lucky to be born with the DNA you had and the parents you had and the place you had, the support you had, the things that came together at just the right time. So it's very demotivating to think of it that way. Because you think, well, if it's just like kind of being hit by lightning, I don't have any control over success, right? But what I say is, it is a little bit like being hit by lightning, but if you want to be hit by lightning, it helps to go outdoors. With maybe a metal object, stick it up there. If that doesn't get it done for you, maybe get a little more aggressive. Maybe you go to a mountaintop where it's known to rain and it's known to have a lot of lightning. Maybe you take a whole bunch of lightning rods, you network them together, and you stand there with your hand in that frickin' lightning rod until something hits you, because the chances are something will. Now, you can't control luck and you can't control the lightning. Well, you can certainly go where the lightning happens, right? And you can certainly say, hey, lightning, I'm here, right? So you have complete control over those things. There was a researcher, Dr. Richard Wiseman, who tried to find out if there's such a thing as luck. You know, are there really lucky people? So he had volunteers who self-labeled themselves either I'm lucky all the time or I'm never lucky, and he studied them to see if there was any difference. And no surprise, there was not. Right? Nobody can guess random events. Nobody can be purely lucky more than anyone else. But he found out in the course of his studies something more interesting. And it happened when he did this test. He gave both groups, the self-described luckies and the unluckies, this task. He said, take this newspaper and count the number of photographs. The people who were unlucky, or called themselves unlucky, counted them up. It took them several minutes to complete this task. They got the number 42, and that was right on average. The people who called themselves lucky also got the same number, but they were done in seconds. The other ones took minutes. These guys were done in seconds, on average. The difference was, on average, that the lucky people noticed that on page 2 of all the newspapers, it said, stop counting the photographs, there are 42. And what he discovered is that people who call themselves lucky expect luck. And what do you do when you're expecting something? You look for it. Right? And they literally had a wider field of perception for, luck. And he found out that if you simply tune yourself to expect it through positive thinking, prayer, it kind of didn't matter your method, but if you just kind of told yourself there's stuff out there and you can notice it, your odds of noticing were actually higher. So that too can be manipulated. So again, you can't change luck, but you can change what you notice, all right? Just like you notice, for example, if you're in a crowded room, you hear, la, 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 Scott, la, 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 you can hear your name. If you tune yourself to be lucky and you're looking for it, there's a little more chance you'll get it. All right, so systems are better if you have a complicated situation in a long time frame. Goals are fine if you have a simple situation in a short time frame. Passion, probably overrated, but physical health and energy, never overrated. Luck, go where the luck is. First thing I did when I graduated from college in my tiny town was sell my car for a one-way ticket to California, move to the Bay Area. I didn't know what was going to happen. I didn't know I'd become the Dilbert cartoon guy. But I knew the odds were better here than they were in my little town of Windham, right? I'm going to close with a few comics that aren't too funny. What is the key to success? Hire the right employees. How do you know you hired the right ones? You know because the business is successful. So the key to success is circular reasoning? Yes, because circular reasoning is the key. I worked around the clock and finished a project that would normally require 10 programmers. Did I just establish a new baseline expectation that will turn my job into a tragic death march? It's time to set some stretch goals. Stupid, stupid, stupid. Experts say lazy employees are the best because they know how to find shortcuts. So you found a lot of shortcuts? Me? No, I'm not lazy. I'm useless. Then why did you bring it up? Why wouldn't I? I'm not lazy. This last one has nothing to do with anything. It's just my favorite comic, so I like to close on this. I'm going to take some questions afterwards, right after this. My boss says we need some Unix programmers. I think he means Unix, not Unix. I already know Unix. If the company nurse drops by, tell her I said never mind. So this concludes the prepared portions of my remarks. Thank you. What's our time? So we have time. I can take a few questions if you have any, and it could be any on any topic. Anything's fair game. Could be voice question. Could be anything. Or it could be no questions at all. I may have. Sometimes I cover things so thoroughly, there's really nothing left to ask. Yeah, I saw a question. Did we actually have a question?
Yep.
All right. Thank goodness. It was going to be lonely up here until that happened.
Thank you. I was actually surprised to hear that you were told that you could lose your voice, and yet you went for it.
Well, when you're doing surgery, you know, anything can happen, right? So what we knew for sure, and, you know, stop me, Dr. Burke, if I say anything that's unmedical sounding, when you're cutting stuff, stuff changes. So if, you know, in the, if a future fix came along, unknown, maybe you would have made that less possible because of the surgery. So it's just an unknown. There's no way really to put a percentage on it. It's just an unknown.
Thank you.
A classic. I mean, I couldn't have a conversation.
Right.
Yeah, I couldn't use the phone. Yeah. If I asked for a Diet Coke, which, and you have no idea how good it feels to be able to say Diet Coke, because. Yeah, you do have an idea. How many people have ordered a Diet Coke and got a Coke? How many people ordered a Diet Coke and just got a blank stare? I got a lot of Cokes. I didn't get a lot of Diet Cokes. Because every time I said diet, it came out, oh, yeah. Anything else? Oh, by the way, I will be around after if anybody wants a selfie. I don't sign things anymore, but selfies are fine.
You're not really a good advertisement for me, Scott, because you're a good advertisement for yourself, and you're a very interesting man. The really interesting thing is when I met Scott Adams, you didn't talk. You almost said nothing to me for a long period of time. Little did I know that it was all sitting up there, and you were just waiting for God to release it somehow. But I remember I had very few words with you, and I'm not very verbose myself, but you were even less at that time. So
well, God was busy, so I'm glad you were available. too easy.
And let me just say one thing. The only funny thing is when I when I finished and I realized, well, this guy's going to do really well, I said to Scott, do you think you could possibly do a Dilbert cartoon and put me in it? And he looked at me with a really straight face and he said, you wouldn't want that.
It's because I'm not a good artist. I just didn't think I could do him justice. All right, was there anything else? Yes. I have, yeah. So I did well in school, but when I came to California, things were terribly just not working out for me. So I actually had my IQ tested to find out if I was really an idiot, and I didn't know it. That's actually literally true. But it was okay. So I got in Mensa. And,
yeah.
No, so the hand spasms was a whole different story and track. I do have that under control. And again, correct me if I'm wrong here, that sometimes these dystonia spasm things travel in pairs. All right. So in a way, the hand problem probably hastened my solution because it's the only way I knew to Google the right solution. So it's kind of a classic case of bad news turning out okay.
How and when was Dilbert born?
Dilbert was first published in 1989. And he was a doodle where I worked. And I bought a book on how to become a cartoonist. That's the fast version. And sent him to some people, and one of them called me back. That's the 10-second version. Yeah. I think we're good, right? Yeah, thank you.